Hey, what's up, everybody? How are you doing as far as September is concerned? Today on Never Quit Nate, we are doing grading NL team seasons up to this point in the season. Yeah, we're gonna like break down what they've done so far. We're gonna tell you where they rank in a lot of like offensive and pitching categories, their record, and what we think they might do. We'll break down what players are living up to it, and overall, just, you know, if you're a B minus or a C plus, that's kind of like average. You should be pretty neutral as a fan base right now. And, you know, above it, below it, how far? We'll do A through F without E. And we'll just give them plus minuses except for F. We're going to start at the top with the Atlanta Braves. We're going to give them a B plus so far this season. The Braves are 26-18. They lead the Phillies by 3 games in the division. It's been a pretty good year for the Braves so far, despite losing a lot of their rotation. A lot of people, reasonably so, do not think that this Braves team would be as good as the one we've seen last year, and maybe not even as good as the one we saw in 2018, but they have been very good so far. They actually hold the 2 seed in the National League right now. The Padres have a better record than them, but the Braves are the 2 seed just above the Cubs. Okay, this team hits like crazy. They have the best OPS in the majors. Wow. They have the 3rd most home runs in the majors. Freddie Freeman's having a terrific season despite that COVID scare at the very beginning. Wow, he's impressive. Ronald Acuna Jr. has missed a little bit of time, but the man is doing even better than the past. That man is not going to struggle. Don't worry about him. Marcelo Zuna has come to Atlanta to absolutely rake. And Adam Duvall, he's a super underrated player. His OPS is over 900 this season. He was underrated last year. And that's a thing. Like, he's a good player for this team. This Braves team, they have good offensive pieces. I've been sleeping on the Braves offense a little. Without Donaldson, they're not missing a beat because Ozuna, his numbers up to this point have been even better than Donaldson's numbers. Dansby Swanson has actually become a pretty good offensive player this year. Can he continue that? That would be huge for Atlanta. And Travis d'Arnaud has just been an elite catcher. That kind of started last year in Tampa Bay for d'Arnaud, but like, geez, what has gotten into him? He was just an eh catcher on the Mets. Now, pitching is obviously the concern of this team. They have the 17th best ERA in the majors, which, all things considered, that's not too bad. But that's what's going to keep this team from being, I don't think they're a top 5 team in baseball, and that's the reason. Bullpen's not the reason. They have a great back end with Shane Green and Mark Melancon. And Minters has been putting up great numbers in that bullpen as well this season. But the rotation is what fell apart. Folty Nevich gone. They DFA'd him. Soroka, the ace, out with an injury for the entire season. And Cole Hamels has not pitched yet. So, and Dallas Keuchel is gone, obviously, to the White Sox. So, this, a rotation. They had a pretty solid one last year, but that's totally fallen apart. The Braves, I think, maybe the most valuable piece to the Braves this year might be Max Fried, because their pitching would be absolutely atrocious without Max Fried. The man still has an ERA under 2, and he's like their only qualifying pitcher as far as amount of innings pitched are concerned. This Braves team, where would they be without Max Fried? As a guy who likes the Mets, the Phillies, I like to say that the Braves are not going to win the division, but they're up 3 games on the Phillies right now. Reality tells me that this Braves team is going to win the division for a 3rd straight year. Yo, chill out. Let's not act like winning the division actually means something in 2020. The 2nd place team right now comes from Philadelphia, the 21-19 Philadelphia Phillies. Where are we going for this grade? This is kind of interesting. We're going to go with a B minus. So, 2nd place is kind of a good place for the Phillies, and their offense has been good. It's just that bullpen is so bad, and they are only 2 games above 500, so we can't go crazy. They have played better of late after a 9-14 start. They've picked it up a lot. Yeah, man, overall, this is a top 10 offense in baseball. They're 17th in OPS.
7th, not 17th in OPS.
They walk a lot. Hoskins walks a lot for this team. Harper walks too. This offense has produced. And Rhys Hoskins has been a huge part of that. In the second half of 2019, he was a big part of the Phillies' downfall. They didn't have a huge downfall last year. It's mainly 2018 that they had a monstrous downfall. They were like 16 games above 500 2 years ago. But then last year, they were just slightly above for a while, and then they finished at 500. But that's besides the point. Rhys Hoskins having a terrific season. He has a 951 OPS this season. The man is totally bouncing back. And JT Realmuto has actually been having a career season. Can you believe it? He's having one of those every year now, by the way. He has an 899 OPS. The man has 11 home runs in his first 40 games. So he's hitting at like a 45 home run pace over 162 game season, which that's amazing. JT Realmuto, the dude has gained a lot of power to his game. And that's over the first 40 Phillies game, not first 40 his games. Harper has gotten ice cold recently, but he is still having pretty much a replicate season as last year, as far as numbers are concerned, with, you know, the 260 type average, the 880, 890 type OPS. And to be fair, that's who Harper is, okay? Maybe one season he'll break out and get that OPS around 1,000, hit 40 home runs, maybe win an MVP. You never know. Harper has obviously the capability to get hot. That's what he can do. However, Bryce, he's just a very solid player as a whole. I think Philly fans have become a little bit willing to accept that Harper's not that top five player in all of baseball, but he is a player who stays healthy and can always produce for them. He's also been very clutch in his time in Philadelphia. The infielders, Gregorius, Segura, they've been what they are. They're average players, and the Phillies will take that. They're average starters. Alec Boehm has been a good rookie for this team. It's a great thing that they called him up. Unfortunately for Scott Kingery, his sophomore season since he became a legitimately solid player has not panned out. He's not actually a solid player anymore. He has been quite horrendous this year after a breakout 2019. All right, so the obvious concern with the Phillies is the bullpen. Now, they're 25th in overall ERA. And Wheeler and Nola have carried that rotation. Now, I said Zach Wheeler is going to be a great pitcher when he signed with the Phillies in the winter. And you know what? That has totally happened. The man, his ERA is very well. It's in the twos. Same with Nola. And that's exactly what this team needs at the top. Although, they can use a little bit more. Arrieta, he is not a good pitcher. It's just reality. A lot of people thought Nola Arrieta would be the 1-2 punch. No, Nola Wheeler is the 1-2 punch. Perhaps you could even say Wheeler Nola is the 1-2 punch. And Zach Eflin, he's a nice guy to have as depth in the rotation. He's a good 3-4 starter, 3 for this team. He's, you know, a mid-4s type of ERA guy. Velasquez, he's just a pretty bad pitcher. But yeah, for the Phillies, that's pretty unfortunate. The reality of Jake Arrieta being washed, that's not good for them after they got him 2 years ago. Not panning out at all. And obviously the bullpen is the downfall of this team. There's not really much to say. Obviously the worst burst bullpen. Obviously they have the worst bullpen in baseball. It's simple as that. I'm not going to even mention any names because pretty much if you walk out of that Phillies bullpen, you're bad. How about the third place team, the Miami Marlins? They're going to get a B+. They sit at 20-19. So, you know, they're losing to Phillies right now. So they're going to be 20-20. So 500 team through their first 40 games. And overall, let's not act like that's so insane. It's not remarkable for a team to go on a 20-20 stretch, even in 2020. Even if you're a bad team like the Marlins. But because this offense is bad, they're 25th in OPS, but I'm giving them a B+, so I should chill with the hate. But yeah, to be fair, it's a bad offense. Jesus Aguilar, he came over in the winter. He's been their best offensive player, or at least their most consistent. That offense has not been good. It's kind of remarkable that one of the worst offenses in baseball is actually at 500, but chill, it's been pretty legit what they've done, I guess. So they just got Starling Marte like 2 weeks ago. He hasn't really done much yet besides hit 2 home runs in 9 games. But the man can actually be a pretty solid pickup for them moving forward. I think, you know, a little bit of a above average player you got there. And Miguel Rojas, the shortstop, you know, a light hitting shortstop in our league. And suddenly that's not the case, at least this year, because he is having a high 900s OPS. The man is going off. How about the Marlins pitching? They're 20th in ERA in the majors, so their pitching is better than their hitting, but when you look, it's still not that good. So, like, I guess this team, I would definitely expect a fall off, but at least they got a lot of Atlanta out of their schedule now. Pablo Lopez was a good starter for them. He was their most consistent, like, you know, every 5 day starter until the Atlanta game. Now he's just having, you know, an average pitcher type of season, which is more so what he is, like a 4.5 year a type of pitcher. But that Atlanta game absolutely killed him. He was the starter in the Atlanta game. And if you guys aren't aware of the Atlanta game, the Braves beat the Marlins 29-9. Like 2 days ago, maybe three. Yamamoto, you know, everyone likes to talk about him when they're like, oh, them Marlins. Yamamoto, oh, no. Yeah, he's not really panned out. He only pitched 4 games, so I'm not, like, hating. But, yeah, he was actually the main culprit of the Atlanta game. The men pitched 2.2 innings. He gave up 12 earned runs. And how can we not mention Sixto Sanchez? You already know, boys, the rookie Sixto Sanchez, the 22-year-old, off to a terrific start in his MLB career. He's pitched, what, like 4 or 5 games? The man has a 180 ERA so far. All right, how about them Mets, the fourth place Mets. All right, but in reality, this team's gonna finish in third, I think. Man, will they pass Philly though? They're a second to third place team, to be honest. But I'm gonna give them a C plus. They're 20-24, and that's what they've been. They've been below 500. They've been 500 over the past like month. And you know, I think 500 is what they are. That's the thing that Mets fans need to kind of chill with, is just thinking that they should be a top 12 team in the majors. No, I'd say like they're around 13-18. They're an average team, which is good. Well, which is average, but you already know that's what the Mets are. Well, the Mets have the third best OPS in the majors. This offense has been elite. Let's get into the whys. The best on-base percentage in all of baseball. Why? Dom Smith is a huge reason why. The man has an OPS at 1.032. Just, you know, he missed a lot of time last year. Hit that walk-off home run against Atlanta in the final regular season game. It didn't mean anything, but it meant something to him, obviously. Conforto having a career season over here. The man has a .340 batting average so far. McNeil has been himself. Nimmo's been himself, which is a bit of an above average player. And Pete Alonso has, you know, not lived up to what he was last year at all. Conforto and McNeil, just in the long term, as in the next couple years, just they might be like just a little bit better players than Alonso in reality. Alonso's pretty fat. My man Robbie Cano, the man, can still play a bit. He has a 902 OPS. His average is, what, 316? Yeah, so far this season. Andrés Giménez is a good idea to call up, and he should be getting most of the playing time at shortstop, hopefully, over Rosario. Rosario's just not a guy who can be a starter on a quality team. That's just reality. Giménez has hit 292 so far. He's been pretty average overall, maybe pretty solid player so far, and the Mets can use that. Shortstop Rosario has been a bit light hitting over his first 3+ seasons as a Met. JD Davis, not quite what he was last year, but he's still been a pretty average baseball player. Dang, the Mets are 18th in the majors in ERA. And obviously that's been carried by Jacob deGrom. The man has a 169 ERA. And I think this is not to say he's a guaranteed Cy Young or guaranteed best ERA in the majors this year or any of that. But it's just overall who you want on your team for a season. Best pitcher in baseball, that's got to be Jacob deGrom. That debate should be closed. Alright, so Brody Van Wagenen come into the season saying that the Mets have the deepest starting rotation in baseball, which basically means you have the best 4 or 5 starters in baseball. That's basically what I take from that, and obviously that is not even close to panned out. Why? Because Porcello and Waka, their depth guys, have not panned out at all. They have both been very, very bad. The rookie left-handed pitcher, David Peterson, has definitely been a pretty big part of this team. He's helped them, but Steven Matz has not helped them at all so far. His ERA is in the 8s. So the bullpen has still dealt with some issues, but as a whole, you can't complain much. Edwin Diaz has actually been back to an elite pitcher. Hello. Back to his 2018 type form. He has maybe blown a bit of games, he has, especially earlier in the season, but the man has just overall been very great. Jerry's Familia has also been, you know, not bad anymore. He's a 3.66 ERA so far in this season, but the rest of the bullpen has not been very reliable. Dellin Betances has not worked out so far. Seth Lugo, that takes away from the bullpen, because Seth Lugo is good, but taking him away from the bullpen and putting him in the rotation, you know, I don't disagree with the Mets for trying that, because the rotation is actually the killer of this team, despite having DeGrom, despite having no more Syndergaard now, no more Stroman for this season. Like, just those guys, not having them for this season is a killer, and this rotation was actually supposed to be the strength of the team. Well, it's the absolute killer of this team. All in all, though, the Mets have not been occupying a spot, but I do think that they're going to capture one of the 8 National League playoff spots.
Go!
And the last team we're going to be talking about, the 16-26 Nationals. No, there's not going to be like 2019 where they have a horrendous start about this far through and then go off. Well, yeah, that's not going to be like that. And obviously a huge reason is because the time is very limited to capture a playoff spot this year. Obviously there's more seeds, but the Nationals do not have a long, long season to still put up a good record when they're starting at 16-26. And hey, without Strasburg, the reality of this team is that they're not that dangerous. All right, so this offense has actually been good. They're 7th in OPS. And across the board, the Nats have a top 10 offense in baseball in 2020. But you know what? Soto has been in a monster, okay? Can we talk about Juan Soto for a sec? The man has 103 at-bats because the season was a bit delayed by COVID-19. But especially, like, considering that he was coming off COVID, that's insane. A 359 average for the man. And the man has a 1.233 OPS. And that's insane. If he was a qualifier, which, man, if he was just playing a little bit more and had that same OPS, it would definitely be the best in baseball. Unbelievable stuff. 67 home runs the man's in his career, and the man is still 21. And man, it would be a lot more than that if there was no delay of the season. He would probably be at like 90 home runs as a 21-year-old. Trey Turner, wow, he's not just a solid player, he's actually a very good player this season. But when you look across the stats for the Nats, it's quite odd that they still have a top 10 offense in baseball when you look and see that Cabrera, Sturbo Cabrera has been bad, Victor Robles has been bad, Adam Eaton has been bad, Eric Thames has been bad, Howie Kendrick has been definitely bad compared to 2019. It's just weird. They're still a top 10 offense. That's Soto and Turner have done mass carrying. But yeah, it makes sense that the Nats have a bad record because their ERA is 24th in the MLB. Their ERA as a team, it's over 5 this season. And they're 29th in WHIP, so that doesn't suggest good things moving forward. Max Scherzer has been disappointing compared to, you know, what we've seen in the past. He's a 3.40 ERA, so like, disappointing, still a very strong ERA for Max. But yeah, can he, even if he might not be elite anymore, which, you know, I'm still dying to see some more elite Max Scherzer, but if that's not going to be the case, could we still get a couple years of solidness from Scherzer? Patrick Corbin's been a little bit disappointing with a 4.34 ERA. He's pitched 8 games. Eibal Sanchez has been arguably the most disappointing player for this team. I'm concerned that he's washed. His ERA is over 6 this season, and he's like, what, 37 years old. Tanner Rainey's been very good out of this bullpen, but when you look across Daniel Hudson, he was just an October story. He's not good this year. Sean Doolittle, not good this year. Hey, what's good, everybody? Thanks so much for watching this presentation of me giving grades to the National League East teams. Now, I really hope to get in the NL Central and the NL West very soon, because obviously the season is ending pretty soon, but if I could get those in within the next, within the week, because what? It's the 11th. I don't want to give, like, grades with, like, less than 10 days left in the season, like, so far type of grades. But hey, I'm obviously not just a baseball channel, but it is kind of my number one thing. But talk basketball a lot, and football, I'll try. But yeah, subscribe if you like sports. I'll see you guys very soon. I don't know exactly how many times a week I'm going to be posting, but I don't know that I'm going to go off a schedule. That kind of seems more like a have-to instead of want-to-do type of vibe when I do that. But you already know, boys, hit that like button. I'm going to be posting 2 to 3, maybe 4 videos a week. You know, we'll see what I feel like. And obviously, it helps me grow my channel.